Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much indeed for coming. My name is Richard Peaker, and I'm the Regional Product Manager with Metso. And myself and my colleague, Lee Crombie, who is the Site Services Engineer, will talk to you this morning about the Metso RCS flotation machine. What we intend to do is to go through in three general sessions. So we have a general introduction to the flotation machine itself. I want to spend some time talking about the machine design, the machine features, and some of the operational controls. We'll then move into the specifics of the Molycorp RCS flotation machine contract and talk about the scope of supply, the overall bank design, and some of the component designs that you have specifically in the Molycorp cells. And the last session will be on installation and operation. And here we're going to talk about the critical installation and commissioning tasks. We'll talk about routine inspection and repair and maintenance. So I think we'll cover all aspects of the cell design for you, and look forward to any questions that you have at the end of each of the three sessions. So the first section is the general introduction. I think it's important, because I'm sure that none of you have actually operated the RCS machine, to have an understanding about some of the design concepts, some of the flow patterns, the instigation of the machine design. Why did we design it in the way that we did? What are the features that those designs will give you? So this is what this session is about, really, is about the machine design, what we've done, what it looks like, why it looks like the way it is. The machine design really started from trying to understand what the mechanism has to do, because that's the heart of the flotation machine. And in the heart of the machine, we've actually got to create bulk slurry flow patterns. Fairly self-evident, but you've got to ensure solid suspension. You've got to ensure good particle bubble contact, because that's at the heart of flotation. And you've also got to ensure that you can resuspend the solids after emergency shutdowns. Another second function of the mechanism is to give effective air dispersion and distribution. Obviously, in order for you to maximize recovery, you've got to ensure that the air gets distributed across the whole cross-section area of the cell to maximize the particle bubble contact. Although you're moving slurry with solids, it does create wear. You want to design the mechanism such that you can maximize that wear life, so you minimize the operating cost of replacement. And given again that you're pumping slurries, it does need power to do that, the machine design ought to try to minimize that power consumption where possible. So all of those elements are part of the mechanism, mechanical design, if you like. The other important part of the mechanism is to ensure that it actually maximizes the mineral recovery. And if you look at any size recovery profile, you will see typically a shape of this inverted U shape here. In the middle section, and these size recovery curves are fairly general for copper, zinc, and lead. They're very mine specific. I mean, these were pulled out of a publication and are used for illustration purposes only. So at a fine size, you get good recovery. Over a size range, you also get good recovery. Recovery falls off at the ultra fine sizes, which is on the left-hand side here, and also falls off at the coarser sizes. And what we were trying to do was try to understand why that is, and also therefore try to incorporate those reasons why into the machine design to try to maximize the recovery at the coarse end and the fine end. At the ultra-fine sizes, the problem really is an attachment problem. You have a bubble which is typically 500 microns in diameter. You have a particle which may be 8, 10, 12 microns. So you're looking at something like a 50:1 size ratio. The problem with that is that flotation only actually occurs when the bubble and the particle actually come into contact, where the particle breaks the bubble surface. If you have a very large bubble relative to the particle size, the bubble itself will push the water film out of the water film away from it. As it's rising through the slurry, it forms, the water actually parts and flows around the edge of the bubble. That flow line prevents ultrafine particles from actually contacting the air surface. And that's where you have this fall off in recovery. So it's an attachment problem. And although you talk to many metallurgists and specialists and experts in the field, nobody is actually really sure exactly where attachment takes place. You have the concept that there's captured by impingement, which is where a bubble and a particle come together in the body of the cell. But on the ultrafine size, there's an issue there because the bubble actually pushes the very fine particles away out of the way of the bubble, so you can't get recovery. If you look at the fall off in the recovery curve with size, what happens, there is obviously still recovery on those fine particle sizes. So the question is where does that take place? And the only place that you can have a small particle contacted by a very much larger bubble without it pushing the particle away is in some high energy region. And the only high energy region in a flotation cell is in the mechanism, zone of the mechanism. So that's one area where we've looked at in mechanism design to try to maximize the recirculation through the high energy region of the impeller to try to maximize the recovery of the ultrafine particles. They're always going to be difficult to recover, but we felt that if we could maximize the passage through the high energy zone, then we would maximize the recovery of those fine particles. At the other end of the scale, then you have an issue with detachment, and that's something which is much less in our control as an equipment machine designer. Most of these are to do with mineral type, grain size, and degree of liberation. Flotation is a very frustrating, call it a science, it's not really a science, it's an art and a science, really. Because the process of capture is the particle has to break the bubble water interface. It has to attach itself to the air side of a bubble. And minerals don't break down neatly across grain boundaries. So you have a chaotic breakage pattern, which typically means that you have a large number of liberated particles, you have a number of middling particles, and then you have a number of gang particles which are fully liberated. The problem with the middle size range unliberated middling particles is that the particle actually has to orientate itself such that the exposed grain, the exposed mineral on the surface of the particle, which is collector coated, because the collector will only coat the target mineral. That only attaches itself to the exposed surface of the mineral that you can see on the surface of the particle. That exposed zone has to hit the air bubble at that point. So you have a particle which has got a small area, which is mineralized, which is collector coated, which now has to orientate itself in the flotation cell to be contacted, to be captured. So that's why you get the middlings particles take an awful lot longer to float. So the retention time for middlings is a lot longer than for liberated particles. Coarser particles, even if they're fully liberated, will have a detachment problem. In other words, you've got a large mass of particle on a bubble. If you have a huge amount of turbulence, that bubble will get stripped off. The particle will get stripped off the bubble because of turbulence. So you have a number of things in this detachment area, because at the end of the day, the particle has got to sit on the bubble, be taken to the surface, go into the froth zone, and then come off of the froth. So it has to stay with that bubble all the way through the process. If you can't get it attached in the first place, you aren't going to recover it. If you get it attached but it detaches itself, it's still not recovered and it's going to go into tailings. So these are the two critical areas, in my view, of performance of flotation machines. The ultrafine size and the coarser size. There's not much that you can do from a machine design point of view about the coarser sizes, because it's mineral type liberation and particle size dependent. All we can do is minimize turbulence. And on the ultrafine size, what we can do is just try to maximize the recirculation through the high energy zone with a view to maximizing the recovery of the ultrafines. The middle size range, 10, 12, 15 microns at the small size, 180, 100, 120 microns in the top size, that floats very well. So you don't really have an issue with those. It's maximizing the two tails of the recovery profile. The RCS mechanism is illustrated here. It is a fully suspended mechanism. What that means is that there is nothing between on the cell floor. So all the mechanism sub-assembly is suspended from the main beams on the cell. It consists of two parts. It consists of a static diffuser, around a rotating impeller. So here we have the static diffuser, and here we have the rotating impeller. Obviously, the shaft that drives the impeller runs down through the standpipe. This arrangement gives us some very interesting flow patterns. It has a primary radial flow pattern out of the impeller, radially towards the cell wall, and then as it hits the cell wall, it gets returned across the cell base into the eye of the impeller. The lower sweep velocity across the bottom of the cell is designed to minimize sanding, and then you have a high flow into the eye of the impeller. So the primary flow pattern is in this direction here, out radially. It's then induced to return by the return flow into the eye of the impeller. And this is a fairly common flow pattern for many of the suspended mechanisms, or many of the blown air machines that are available on the marketplace. The key feature that distinguishes the RCS mechanism from all the other mechanisms is that we open the top of the impeller up, and we actually allow secondary recirculation into the high energy zone. And this is purely because we believe that ultrafine recovery is in the high energy region, and that we need to get the ultrafine particles that are not captured back into the mechanism again to have another pass through a high energy region. And that's what this open-topped impeller does for us. So those are your two primary flow patterns. If you didn't have this upper flow pattern, what would happen is any material that flows into this top region of the cell would not be returned back into the high energy region, because it would pass up here and it would come back again and come down here again in a slow, slow, slow vortex. So that's why we wanted to open the top of the cell up. It actually also does a number of other things for us. It restricts the high energy zone to the lower part of the cell, so that you have good particle suspension. It also does a second thing for us. It gives us a quiescent zone above this zone here. In this region here, above this little horizontal object here, you have a fairly quiescent region. So once you've got capture in the bottom here, then you allow a transport zone to the froth surface. So that minimizes the possibility of the coarse particles actually dropping off the cell. The cells are circular. There are no vertical baffles in the cell whatsoever. The only baffle that we have is a horizontal shelf baffle, which you can see in red in the center of the view here. That does two things for us. It confines the high velocity flow patterns to the bottom of the cell. It also prevents the flow from passing up the cell wall. This flow here, without this horizontal shelf baffle, would actually come out to the cell wall and then rise up here along the cell wall itself. And that would lead to turbulence on the cell surface. So this horizontal shelf baffle confines the high velocity flows to the base of the cell, and also, you know, gives us a smooth froth slurry interface. And that's important when you're talking about recovering the coarser particles, because you want those to come off the cells very quickly to maximize recovery. So a bit more detailed view of the mechanism itself of the impeller. We have a static diffuser, as you can see here on the left-hand side. In the center, we have the rotating impeller. The vanes are vertical, which means that you can reverse the direction of rotation of the impeller. In fact, we recommend that you reverse the direction of rotation of the impeller to even out the wear parts. Initially, one would be looking at probably every 3 months, but inspection on the wear surfaces would decide whether you need to reverse it more frequently or less frequently. The detailed design of the impeller is as shown there. The air in a rotating impeller with vertical vanes, which you're putting air onto, what happens is that the air enters the impeller, and on the low pressure trailing edge side of the impeller, you have an air cavity which forms. So the air passes from the shaft into the air cavity, and from the air cavity it gets shed off into the slurry. If you look at this central zone here, we have a hollow shaft here, and the hollow shaft terminates in an air port between each vane. If this impeller is rotating from right to left, then on the low pressure side, which is this side of the vane here, you have an air cavity. So you have a direct connection between the air inflow and the air cavity itself. And on the opposite side of the same zone, you have a very strong slurry flow, because you're pumping up from the base of the impeller and then radially outwards from the vane. The air shelf, which is this disc-shaped device here, prevents the air from simply migrating up through the impeller and going around the shaft. So that holds the air cavity in place. So you have all the ingredients of being able to give good airflow from the shaft into the air cavity, from the air cavity into the slurry, and disperse into the slurry. The vanes themselves are shaped the way they're shaped to give increasing pumping with radial flow. What that was designed for was to prevent microturbulence within the center of the impeller to maximize the wear life. So if you have a vane which is increasing pumping with radius, the rate of pumping increases all the time. Therefore, you don't get any recirculation back into the impeller. It maximizes the pumping, minimizes the turbulence within the zone itself, and maximizes the wear life. There's a couple of, I think we've got three videos here which illustrate some of these flow patterns. These are not super accurate, they're representative only of the flow patterns, but they give an idea of some of the features that you'll see in the full-size machine. So this is just the primary solids flow within the body of the cell. I mean, as we said before, it's a radial flow out. It goes towards the cell wall. It then flows across the base of the cell and into the eye of the impeller, and then we have a top flow recirculation back into the top of the mechanism, as we talked earlier on. One of the advantages of circular cells is that because they're circular, you have the same flow patterns all the way around them. Those of you who are familiar with the DR machines will know that the flow tends to focus in the corners. You need to have horizontal shelves to prevent the flow actually migrating up the corner of the cell and causing turbulence on the cell surface. Circular cells don't have that issue because they're all circular. You don't get any flow focusing. It's all symmetrical. The other benefit of the circular cell is that you're able to control short-circuiting much better than you can do in a square cell. And one of the areas that we focused on was to minimize short-circuiting by looking at how the new feed actually enters each individual cell. Because it's a very random process within the body of the flotation machine, you're trying to, ideally you want all particles to stay in the bank of flotation cells for exactly the same amount of time. And this is your design retention time, which you develop from test work and other processes. If in reality that doesn't happen, you have a distribution of retention times or residence times. And really, as a machine designer, all you can do is you can make sure that each particle gets into the mechanism of every mechanism of every cell at least once. What happens after that is a random process, but at least every particle must go into the mechanism once. And that's really controlled by how you feed the machine, what the machine shape is like. Circular cells are great because you've got symmetrical flow patterns, but you also have to pay attention to how the new feed arrives into the cell and how that interacts with the existing flows in the cell. And this illustrates that point here. The yellow particles on the left-hand side here represent the new feed coming in from the upstream cell. And if you'll notice here, this radial flow pattern at this point of time here is actually downflow. Now, it's downflow in this particular point where the new feed is, but it's also downflow in the two adjacent zones to that feed point. In fact, it's downflow all the way around the cell. So if you put your feed in so that it only gets into the downflow region, then the flow in the cell is actually forcing the new feed into the eye of the impeller. Because it comes in, it's in a downflow region. As soon as it goes down, it's now constrained on each side. It can't go left or right because the adjacent flows are going into the eye of the impeller. And that's what this little video clip actually illustrates. The yellow is the new feed. All the particles will come in from the feed port here, which is illustrated by this slight step here, will go into the downflow region, will flow across the base of the cell, will flow into the eye of the impeller, will now come out of the impeller in a random radial distribution. Who knows where it's going to go? Some particles may go around in this circle for significantly longer than the retention time. Some particles may come in, go out, and go down here, go out of the valves, go into the next cell. You can't control that. All you can control as a machine designer is you can control the new feed going into the mechanism at least once. and that's where you get residence time distribution. And that's why circular cells and the RCS machine in particular is significantly better in terms of minimizing short circuiting than the old DR machines or the square cell machines, because you've controlled the flow and the flow patterns control the residence time. The third slide here basically shows what happens when you turn air onto the machine. And it's obviously fairly self-evident. The air bubbles will come out of the machine, they will mix with the slurry, and they will give you impingement, which is the particles and bubbles coming together in the body of the machine itself. That's how you're going to get some flotation capture, and you get recirculation back into the eye of the impeller for the ultrafine capture. You've got your highly turbulent lower zone in the bottom of the cell for particle suspension, and you've got a relatively quiescent upper part of the cell for transport. You've got yourself a relatively quiescent froth-slurry interface so that you're able to run with shallow froths. So all the component parts of what we believe is the ideal cell design are present in the RCS machine. This is a computational fluid dynamics CFD picture, and this, if you like, illustrates the flow patterns that we wanted to develop in the machine, we did develop in the machine, and this, if you like, validates the flow patterns are there. You can see the very strong radial flow patterns from the center of the impeller. This point here, you can see the strong downflow region, you can see the strong return flows across the base of the cell. You can see the secondary return flows coming across the cell going towards the eye of the top of the impeller. And you can see the relatively quiescent zone at the top here. The length of the arrows and the color of the arrows actually represents their direction and strength. So if you're looking here in the impeller itself, you've got long arrows of a lighter blue going to orange, which represents faster and faster flows. And then you've got shorter lines here illustrating very much more quiescent flows. So the areas that we were talking about earlier was this very active lower zone for suspension and contact, this quiescent upper transport zone above this horizontal shelf, and that leads itself to a very stable froth slurry interface. Again, that's important for flotation operation, for you to minimize your froth depth, should you need to minimize your froth depth to maximize your middlings recoveries. This is another pair of computational fluid dynamics pictures illustrating another aspect of machine design that is important to remember, if you like, when you're looking at maybe increasing the feed rate or changing the plant design or moving the cells to a different duty. This won't apply immediately, but I'm sure down the road somewhere there'll be some opportunities to modify or to improve the performance of the plant. And this is an area where you need to be aware of that there are limitations to the relationship between the cell size and the feed rate. Obviously, by having a circular cell, you have smooth flow patterns. You have radial flow patterns, and they move in all directions across the base of the cell. If you have a medium flow rate, that inflow at this point here doesn't really affect the performance of the machine, because the new feed rate is close to the velocities in the bottom of the cell. So you don't disturb the lower flow patterns very much. If, however, you actually increase the feed rate significantly, this is potentially what could happen. You could begin to overwhelm the return flow on the other side of the machine here. In normal operation, with a relatively low flow compared to the pumping rate of the mechanism, these flows at the base of the cell will flow in quite strongly. If you have very high feed rates, what happens is that the feed material will come in at the feed side here, will flow into the mechanism because that's the general flow direction, but it will begin to overwhelm the return flows on the other side. And we always check when we have an inquiry with design flow rates, we always make sure that the design flows are nowhere near the overwhelming flow, which is what this represents here of the mechanism. So there's certainly no issues in any of the machines that we sell, because we always check this out. But it's an illustration of what might happen at some time down in the future if you're looking to modify or to change the flow sheet. Beginning to introduce some, basically just some names of what we would refer to as we go through the presentation, so that we try and use the same words for the same things. The mechanism itself is fully suspended, as we were talking earlier. And this is the mechanism sub-assembly here, where we have the spindle bearing, which is supported by the mechanism subframe here. From the mechanism subframe, the standpipe is bolted and hangs down from the subframe. and we bolt the diffuser on the end of the standpipe and the impeller on the end of the shaft. That whole subframe rests on a pair of crossbeams, which run across the cell, and that supports the mechanism. The shaft is hollow, and the air goes in through the shaft at the top through a rotary air swivel. Obviously, around that you have the V-belt drive, you have the motor, you have a motor subframe which supports the motor itself. The motor is sitting on adjustable support plates so you can adjust the V-belt tension. Because the mechanism is a complete subassembly, then there are two alternative ways of repairing the replacing the wear parts, because you will need to at some point in time replace the wear parts. In larger machines, there is a clear opportunity to use either of these two methods. With very small machines, because of the space restriction, there may not be an opportunity to go into the tank to replace the wear parts, and we may have to remove the mechanism in its entirety to replace the wear parts. This will depend very much on how much physical space there is inside the cell. And I know you get into confined space issues as well with plants when you're going into smaller tanks. So there's a safety issue there. But on larger cells, you can use either of these two methods. On smaller ones, it may not quite be so relevant. Because the mechanism is a single subassembly, then you can actually allow the complete mechanism to drop into the tank, be removed from, and be put back into the tank as a complete subassembly. Obviously, after you take the V-belt drive off, you can undo the bolts which bolt the subframe onto the main beams, and which tie the main beams back to the motor support plate, take the V-belt drives off, and you can just lift the complete mechanism out. That will probably be your preferred method of repairing the cells at the Molycorp site because of the small size of the tanks. However, if the cells were of a larger, or if you have some people who are quite happy to work in fairly tight confined spaces, then there is another alternative way in which you can replace the wear parts, which is simply to leave everything in place. Leave the subframe in place, leave the V-belt drive in place, drive covers, and get into the tank and unbolt the diffuser segments and also unbolt the impeller. And they can be lifted out. Anybody here who's familiar with DR machines, the Denver DR machines, will know that it's a nightmare. You have to pull the mechs. You can't get into the tanks because you've got on the smaller cells, you've got a one-piece diffuser, you've got a central bolt holding the impeller in place. You can't do that in situ. You have to pull the mechs every time you want to change the wear parts. With the RCS machines, you have an option. With the very small cell sizes, I'm not sure how much that option of not pulling the mechs applies. It's something you'll have to evaluate for yourselves when you look at the cell sizes. So these are relatively small mechanisms, so the component parts are relatively light. I mean, I think you still need to have cranes to move the diffusers and the impellers because they are cast high chrome, so they are heavy. So you will have to use slings to move them. But it may very well be that you can replace a number of mechanisms in a shift simply by pulling the mechs out, replacing the wear parts, dropping them back in again and rebolting them up. The maintenance process is very straightforward to repair the wear parts. This is just a little summary of what we've been talking about. The RCS will give you enhanced flotation performance. It gives you maximum particle bubble contact, effective solid suspension, controllable aeration. One of the two basic types of flotation machine are self-aerating machines of the Wemco style, where you don't have any possibility to have good control of the air, or blown air machines, of which the RCS is one of a number of competing designs. In our view, air control is a critical variable, critical operating variable you need to be able to manage. And we believe that that is only really effectively done by having a low pressure air supply from a separate blower, which is the design that you have here. The machine itself, we designed the impeller to minimize as much turbulence as we can through the impeller to maximize the wear life. There's also an element of design there which does actually minimize the absorbed power, and we're using cast polyurethane in our standard machines. Cast polyurethane is the wear component. In this particular case, because of your high operating temperatures at 195 degree F, we can't use cast polyurethane because that swells and softens at high temperature. So this is why we elected to use cast high chrome. And the third point about the mechanism is the improved maintenance. It's a one-piece fully suspended mechanism, which means that you can either pull the mechanism completely out of the cell and replace the wear parts, or on the larger cell sizes, it's certainly much more convenient to leave everything in place and replace the wear parts in situ. Looking at the cell design itself, and again, a number of design features. The most interesting one, well, you can see in the center here, the mechanism sub-assembly, the subframe, the impeller and diffuser. The wear patterns in the cell are interesting because the only critical wear area in the cell is in the high turbulence regions where either where we have swirl or where the flow changes direction. Within the cell itself, the critical area for wear is immediately beneath the diffuser. This is where the flows are coming in. You have a rotating impeller, it creates swirl. So this is the region here on the bottom of the cell where you have the highest potential for wear in the body of the cell. We don't see any wear on the cell walls because by the time the flow gets to that position, the velocity is dissipated such that you don't have a huge amount of abrasive action on the cell walls. The other two areas where you have a potential for abrasion, or potential for wear rather, is where the slurry changes direction. In the feed box, which you can see here on the left-hand side, the feed is an open-top feed box. The slurry will pass down the outside of the tube here, this feed box itself, and enters the cell at this lower zone here, rather like the animation I showed earlier. The flow will flow vertically, then go horizontally. This is a turbulent region at the bottom of the feed box. There are wear plates in that location. The other location where you have high wear is where the slurry passes through dart valves and out into the next cell. That's another area where we have wear plates. So in the bottom of the cell is a central wear plate, and then you have the high regions of the feed box and the connecting boxes. And again, I appreciate that this shows here an external intermediate and discharge box. I know we have internal ones, and I'll come onto that in a second, but this is a more general presentation about the general design and general design options. The interesting feature here about the feed box is that we've actually extended the top of the feed box. When we were looking at the design, this was done in the mid-90s, 1990s, we walked around a number of plants looking at operations and looking at elements that we might be able to take care of in the design. And one of the most notable features of some plants was the amount of spillage on the floor. A lot of that came from overflowing feed boxes. So we said, this is crazy. All you actually have to do with a feed box is extend the walls up and then put a return port back into the cell. So any froth that you generate in the feed box, which you will do if you have a fairly stable foam, will go back into the cell and not overflow the other way onto the floor. So on feed boxes and conventional external intermediate and discharge boxes, we have return ports back into the cell so that you should have no spillage from the froth in the feed box. And you can see this extension piece here where it comes up higher than the top of the cell, and then there's a little port here where it actually drops back into the cell. In the Molycorp design, we have peripheral launders. This shows the cross-flow launder, but we believe that the peripheral launders are actually more effective, so that we have a peripheral launders at the Molycorp or the Molycorp cells. And the overflow from the feed box actually drops into the froth concentrate launder. So it doesn't even go back into the cell, it actually goes as concentrate. We talked about the main support frames, which you can see these two parallel beams running across the top of the cell. They support the mechanism, they obviously act as stiffeners for the top of the tank, and they also act as support for either walkways where we don't have insulation, or the insulation where we do have insulation issues. On the Monocoupe froth launder design, the peripheral launder, what we have here is, you can see, this is the shell of the tank here, as you come down the side here. And the froth lip, the peripheral launder lip, is this element here as it comes around the cell. And what you'll notice is that the froth launder floor is this floor piece here. And you'll see it's actually obviously gravitating down towards a single froth outlet port. But the other interesting point here is you've got this, the froth launder internal wall actually extends to the same depth all around the cell. And then there's a 45 degree chamfer plate taking you back to the actual cell wall. The reason for this is that we have a circular cell. We have created bulk slurry flow patterns, homogeneous flow patterns, all the way around the cell. If you put an internal launder with a falling floor, in other words, if all you had was a falling floor launder here, this would act as simply as a channel for the air to come up. So you would actually allow the air to fall, go underneath this floor here, and it would come to the highest point, and you'd have a huge amount of froth arriving at the highest point of the launder itself. So what we did was we said, no, this is not right from a metallurgical point of view. From a cell design point of view, it costs more money because you're putting more metal into the system. But from a metallurgical performance point of view, we said, no, you actually have to have your peripheral launder showing the same shape change all the way around the cell. So you've got here, you'll see when you look inside the cells, you will see that the peripheral launder, actually the plate is all the same all the way around. You have a chamfer piece at the bottom here to the cell wall. And if you look inside, you'll find a falling floor launder base, which actually takes the slurry out of the system. Level control. A good level control is at the heart of good operation of the flotation machine. And there have been a number of different devices designed to, or developed and installed and operated to actually monitor the slurry level. The challenge that you have with froth is that you can't see the slurry level. And you have a problem trying to detect where that slurry level is. There's pressure devices, there's all kinds of devices. The common standard device nowadays is to use a float and target plate. The float itself would sit on the froth slurry interface, so it floats on the slurry level itself. And because your froth surface is a turbulent surface itself, you need to have whatever device you're going to use to detect the change in level of the float, you need to have that away from the froth surface itself. So what everybody does, and we're no different, is you have a float and target plate. So you have a float which sits actually at the froth slurry interface. It's connected by a rod which runs through a support bracket to a target plate on top of that rod. So obviously the target plate moves up and down with the float. What you need then is a device to detect the change in distance between the float, between the target plate and the detection device. In many cases, people use ultrasonic transmitters. In Monicorp's case, we were asked to use a radar level transmitter. Doesn't really matter. Ultrasonic, radar, they should both perform in exactly the same way. All they're doing is monitoring and sending out a 4 to 20 milliamp signal proportional to the change of gap between the target plate and the radar detection device. That signal then goes to a PID controller, which sends out a 420 milliamp signal through to the valve actuators, which actually position the valve. So when the liquid level rises above the set point, it sends a signal through to the PID computer, back to the actuators, say, okay, liquid level is too high, I need to allow more liquid to flow out of this vessel, so I will open the dart valves. So you have dart valves with a pneumatic actuator attached to them at the top, which does the moving. So it's a double-acting pneumatic actuator, so it powers open and powers closed. Connected to the dart valves by a valve stem. And we always use downflow dart valves. That basically means that the outlet of the dart valve is actually on the same physical level as the base of the cell. And the reason we do that is simply because you will have coarse particles in your float cells. No matter how well you control your grinding circuit, it will happen. You want that coarse particle to get out of the cell so it doesn't actually cause you wear. It will actually sit in the corner of the cell between the floor and the walls, because that's a very low flow region. So if you have some coarse particles, it will tend to sit out in the corner of the cell in this sort of location here. So you get like a little cusp of settled material in the bottom of the corner of the cell. But should you have coarse particle movement, it does have to get out of the cell at some point in time. So it will flow out of the downflow dart valves. Other designs, in fact, old Denver designs, and I've been with the company for sort of 30 odd years, so I go too far back to, I'm almost beyond memory. But they had upflow valves. I know why they had upflow valves, because it was actually less force on the valve, because your slurry going up through the valve actually counteracts some of the valve weight, and take some of the load off the actuator. But the issue with upflow valves is that typically there's maybe a step of 10 inches between the valve outlet and the base of the cell. So no matter how much you drain those cells down, you're going to have a 10 inches depth of solids in there, which you have to get out. So you would normally have to have drain, you're mandatory to have drain ports in the cells to get that last 10 inches out. With downflow valves, you can actually flush your solids, your cells through the dart valves. I know in the Modicorp design, there are specific drains in each cell, and this was a requirement from Lintec, but this is fine. Yeah, I mean, people do have drains on each cell. Maybe you want the slurry to go to a different position in the circuit. So we're quite happy to put them in there, but in reality, you don't need to if you can handle your tank drainage through your dart valves. And you can only do that with downflow dart valves. You can't do it with upflow dart valves. So the standard, or one of the two standard designs, is an external dart valve. The other is an internal dart valve, which of course is a design that you have here at Molycorp, where we minimize the bank length, we minimize the bank cost by putting the valves into the cell. It is, from a hydraulic point of view, a little bit less efficient in terms of short-circuiting, because your valves are now within the body of the cell. But as compensation to that, you have much shorter bank length, because you don't have to have an external box there, so you can squeeze your bank up. This may have significant capital cost implications by minimizing the building size. So the valves are internal. They are still downflow. You can see them here on the bottom of the cell. Dart valve seat. And we'll look at this in a little bit more detail when we come into the detailed design for the Molycorp cells. This is more of an introduction to the cell design. The connecting box goes from this cell to the next cell down in the bank. Here, this is where the next cell will bolt directly onto this flange face here. And there's some guides here with support from the cell wall, so that the valve stems themselves will move up and down in a fairly controlled manner. We have a support for the actuators sitting on some port frames. The area that we pay attention to here is you're now moving these valve stems a little bit closer to the mechanisms, so you're in a slightly higher velocity region, so there is potential for wear. So we would cover this bottom portion of the dart valve stems with rubber to minimize abrasion on there. So as we'll see later on, this is an area for inspection. You look at all the wear parts, the impellers, the diffusers, the wear plates, the valve stems, the valves, the valve seats, the internal portions of the connecting boxes here, because this is also a turbulent region here. So all these areas need to be inspected, and we cover this in the third session of this presentation later on. But this is what we're talking about when we're talking about the connecting boxes. Air control. On larger sizes, we'd recommend that you have automatic airflow control, because you're talking about relatively large volumes of air. You're talking about a system which is in balance itself. So when you go from hot day temperature to cold night temperatures, the mass of air changes, so the volume of air actually changes going into the cell. As you go smaller and smaller cell sizes, the need to have automatic control diminishes, because you don't get such a large volume change for change in air temperature. And I know that on these cells you have manual control, which is perfectly adequate for controlling small cells. The air flow is from distribution main header, normally either adjacent to or below the cell banks themselves, going up into a flange from where we take our supply, starts at this point here, which you'll see in the next section. Steel pipe and a manual air control valve, and then a flexible hose going through to the air swivel with suitable clips. I know, talking earlier on, that the cells are actually installed, but this is a little bit superfluous, but from a general presentation point of view, it illustrates some of the features that we designed into the cells. We tried to make the cells modular where this is possible. I know that, for example, on the six cell banks here, you have two groups of three cells which are identical. So this just illustrates, it has a whole series of just illustrated slides showing how the bank is built up. This is obviously the first stage of your installation process, to get the fabrications in place, And then from there, you can begin to put in all the components. So we're talking about basically the RCS design, the enhanced performance from the hydraulic flow zones, the minimizing short circuiting, the improved access. When you are able to put cell top walkways, you certainly get significantly improved access. And when you're talking about installation cost, you're talking about using the circular cells to be able to minimize building space, using the circular cells or using internal dart valves to minimize bank length and therefore building space again. Single side froth discharge for froth handling, and where you're able to take advantage of it, the modular tank design for installation. That's the end of section one, folks.
How often do the wear parts of the impellers and diffusers need to be replaced with the cast high chrome installation we have at Molycorp?
A normal cast polyurethane can last anywhere from, I think, about 9 months, which is on a crushed high chrome, or in South Africa, which is extremely abrasive and extremely angular, to an excess of 4 or 5 years. And I would expect that your high chrome impellers would be lasting at least a year, probably 2 years. But within the first few months of operation, it's really important to establish a baseline, if you can, of some wear characteristics. If you see nothing after 3 months, then go to a 6 month inspection window. And if you see nothing after 6 months, then maybe go to a 9 month one. So basically use the initial stages of operation to give you some feel for the wear characteristics and wear life and stability of the operation. I would be surprised if it's less than a year. I would not be surprised if it was more than 2 years.
One of the questions that we worry about at Molycorp is the high specific gravity of our material. And so things like sanding in the launders, sanding in the bottom, things like that concern us. Could you talk about your design and, you know, how it's able to handle the higher specific gravity materials? You know, we're talking typically the 3.8 specific gravity material.
We have, I'll address the question specifically, but just a general answer, we've got cells successfully operating on both galena and sphalerite. So sphalerite, I think, is about 5, galena is about 7. So they're significantly heavier than the minerals that you're talking about. So I don't really have any specific issues. The launders themselves are sloped at 6 degrees, which we found to be very, very acceptable. So I don't see it as an issue. I don't see it as an issue on the operation of the cell itself, because again, we've got operations on galena concentrate, which is running around 6.5, so I don't see any issues with suspension in the body of the cell. I don't see any issues in terms of the feed or the connection points. I don't really see any issues in terms of the froth launder design either. So I think you should be well covered there.
When you're separating the diffusers and the impeller from the shaft, are you dealing with any shim packs?
No. In the RCS machine, there are no critical clearances. The pumping rate, the pump velocities, the radial flow patterns are all generated by the shape of the impeller and the diffuser vanes. You will find that you have wear at the top of those. That's when you need to look to change it. Reverse the direction of the impellers. There are no critical clearances needed. The only area where there is wear that you need to inspect on a regular basis is at the bottom of the standpipe, where the shaft exits the bottom of the standpipe. There are what we call bump bearings, but these actually are a high temperature plastic. And what they do is they actually prevent the shaft from moving so that the impeller contacts the diffuser. It won't happen because the shaft is like 5 times over stiff that we need to make it stiff. But the gap between the shaft and the bump ring is half the gap between the impeller and the diffuser. So that actually prevents, if you have something, I mean, significantly solid that gets in there, it will move that shaft. I'm talking about maybe a wrench or something that somebody drops in there by mistake, piece of scaffold, whatever. I mean, all sorts of things gets into float cells, certainly in the initial startup stages. There's nothing critical in terms of the clearances on the impeller that you need to worry about during operation. We've taken all those concerns out of the design.
If you start to push the cell, like feeding it more and more, mm-hmm. would you tend to get more and more bypass?
Only if you exceed that critical velocity that we talked about on those CFD pictures. Below that point, it's not going to have any effect. All it's going to do is it's just going to modify the bottom recirculating, the bottom return flow pattern slightly. So I showed you, if you like, the low flow to the maximum flow. And even at the maximum flow, there was still no breakthrough. But up to that point, no. I wouldn't see any hydraulic changes in the behavior of the machine. Metallurgical changes for sure. I mean, you can double the flow rate, you halve the retention time, so you know. It's going to give you an issue on recovery, but in terms of flow patterns, hydraulic nature of the flows, no.
I have a question about the froth layer and the design. I thought I recalled seeing a froth crowder mm-hmm. around the central
standpipe. Correct.
And one of the questions I have, I understand the froth crowder, but one of the questions I have is, does the whole mass of liquid rotate in the cell?
No. There is no bulk rotation of the slurry. That's why we're able to not to have any vertical baffles in the cell at all. The slurry flow patterns are controlled by the vein spacing, or at least the rotation, or otherwise, if you like, of the bulk mass is controlled by the vein spacing. When we first developed the machine, we were looking at having a lot less veins in the diffuser. And we had significant bulk rotation. In fact, we had enough bulk rotation for a vortex to be drawn down from the liquid surface. And that's drawn down something like maybe 4 feet, 5 feet, because we had the first cell we built was on a tank that was about 8 foot diameter and about 8 foot deep liquid. And we could pull a strong vortex down from the cell surface into the eye of the impeller, and the whole contents of the tank was rotating. And we thought, simple, we'll just put some vertical baffles in there. So we got some scaffold planks, and the scaffold planks are 8 inches wide. We had a tank that was probably 6 foot wide or something like that. More than adequate to suppress any rotation that we thought. Put four of those in there, no effect. You had significant bulk rotation in the center of the cell. And what we said was, okay, well, let's have a think about this. And what actually we came to the conclusion was that the rotation was caused by a kickover in the return flow pattern from the mechanism. If you have your vein spacing too wide, then it actually, the flow pattern that comes out of the mechanism here, and then there's a swirl here, so it actually goes this way. So the flow comes out, goes at an angle, and then goes back into the impeller again. That return angle flow sets up the bulk rotation patterns. So you can't suppress that by putting a vertical baffle in here, because this return flow here towards the cell wall creates this circular flow pattern. So what we did was, you close up the spacing on the diffuser, which actually kicks that return flow pattern more vertical. If you haven't got any radial movement on the return flow, you've got no rotation. So there is no rotation in the cell. You might get a tiny little bit, but effectively no rotation.
Last question about the liquid level surface. Is there rocking of that, or is it how stable is it? One of the things that you could see in some of the older cell designs is that the liquid level would rock.
Yes. I believe it's one of the most stable machines on the market today. Contrast that with, and the reason is that it's this horizontal shelf that prevents, if you didn't have the horizontal shelf there, what would happen is that the radial flow would hit the cell wall and would simply migrate up the cell wall. And that migration would give you an unstable slurry surface, which unfortunately on a peripheral launder is actually by the froth lip. So it could actually act as a little dam. If you've got flows coming in from the froth lip itself, that could actually prevent the froth from getting off the cell. But with a horizontal shelf, what you do is you actually prevent that, the flow from coming out from the wall here and then returning up the cell wall. You put a horizontal shelf in here, what happens is it stops that flow. So you don't have strong vertical flows on the cell wall, which means that you have a very quiescent upper zone. So I think that you can run with probably 1.5 inch froth depths, should you need to. I don't expect you will do, but you could run that shallow if you wanted to, without having slop over.